dig in a little bit to the confusing part of the process, which is the mortgage. Everybody here is a renter currently, right? Okay, so my mission and passion in the mortgage world is that I came from education. I got into the business in 2006, so I'm 13 years in. And not long after, as a young, broke and in debt person, I bought my first house. And later turned into a rental property, and within 9 years, my husband and I bought 6 homes because we discovered it's so much easier than we ever thought. And it actually gave us our start and our path to financial freedom. And so I'm really passionate about educating folks through just how easy the mortgage process actually is and can be, and how much more accessible homeownership is, and how it can, for some folks who want to go this path, it can become a supplemental income that can allow you to live the life of your dreams, regardless of whatever income you're bringing home from the job that you love and are passionate about. So it's ultimately allowed us to live full-time in Winter Park, Colorado. It's allowed us, my husband, to quit his job and manage our properties. So not that everybody's on that journey, but I always say it's the best accident that ever happened, that we bought our first house when we did, and then like what's come of it within the last 10 years has just been absolutely life-changing. And so it's my like mission and passion in life is to inspire others to kind of dream bigger and think bigger, because I feel like we all go our journey with our career, and we get the income we can get, and if there's ways to create a supplement to that so that you can have that perfect balance of having a job that you love and having the financial freedom piece, yeah, it's just pretty amazing. So we're gonna dig in a little bit. So
yes,
look forward to helping you guys.
So our goal for the day is understanding the loan process, which Erin's gonna be talking about, and then understanding the buying process, which I'll be talking about, and then how she mentioned how real estate can help you build your wealth, and then questions. And then we thought it would be fun sometime later this spring or early summer to do a follow-up and do a happy hour either somewhere or maybe here. Yeah, cool. So the first thing when you want to begin buying, if you sit down with the realtor first, I'll go through everything with you, but I will then tell you you need to speak with the lender. So, Erin, will you
tell us? Okay, well, we're going to swap out here in our presentations. So we're going to talk a little bit about the goals for today from the mortgage perspective. And as I kind of alluded to already, my goal is to, number one, debunk the myths about what it takes to buy real estate. Number two, we're going to go through a number of different options that are what we call minimal entry into buying a home. So there's still a lot of misunderstanding in the marketplace that we need to have a 20% down payment. You know, we need to have $80,000 in the bank before we can buy our first home. And the reality is that you can actually get into a home with as little as $5,500, which can come from your savings, from your retirement, from a gift from a relative, whatever makes sense for our clients. And so we're gonna go through a couple different types of loan programs here. Now, the goal is not to overwhelm you. The goal is to show you that there are so many ways to go about buying real estate that at the end of the day, if your wheels get turning and you wanna know more, each one of you is gonna have a unique situation. Every file that we work on, every transaction that we do, every relationship we have is unique to the individual. So ultimately, all you guys need to know is that, okay, this might be more accessible than I thought, and maybe what we should do is find out the facts. So if you're curious when this presentation is over, all you need to do is reach out to us. We'll have you guys do a simple application. We'll dig into actual numbers, options available to you, and then you'll have the facts. Because I think that the biggest thing that I see with folks that are renting is just a false assumption that it's not feasible, at least not right now. And then when you get the facts, you're like, oh, wait a minute, like I could actually buy a home sooner than I thought, or I know exactly what I need to do to get from where I am to where I need to be to do so. And that's it, that's the goal, is just to kind of get that clarity. Do you have the,
yeah,
okay, is it gonna work? Is it the right?
Okay.
Technology?
I can click it for you over here. That's better.
Come on.
Woo!
Or try the computer.
Zoom.
Aim it towards the computer.
Okay.
Maybe
not. You want to click for me?
Yeah.
Actually, I should go ahead and introduce some of my team members that are here as well. So I'm a branch manager for Fairway Mortgage, which is a national mortgage bank. I always say it's not a household name for everybody because residential first mortgages. We don't have credit cards or car loans or lines of credit or anything else. So typically folks don't hear about Fairway until they need a mortgage. But we have a number of branches in Colorado. I own one branch, and then Molly over here, I refer to as my work wife. So as I mentioned, I'm in Winter Park. I have an office there, and we have an office on Railway Parkway downtown. And Molly is our boots on the ground here in Denver. Also former neighbor, great friend, and amazing person. So collectively, we try to make sure that we provide a great experience for the clients. You can go ahead and click.
Okay. And that's my computer. Say on that note too, Erin and I have worked together. She's helped a couple of my clients navigate their way with their loan and their first home buying process too. So when you work with a real estate agent and a lender, they're really working together as a team throughout the process. So you do want to hire a lender that you trust, and if you don't know anyone, usually a real estate agent, I'll refer a couple lenders for you guys. And again, we're gonna work together through the transaction.
Okay, it's not responding to the changes on the laptop. So, when we are working with our clients, the first thing we have you guys do is fill out like a 10-minute application on our website. With that information, you create a file in our system. We send you an email with a link to register yourself. You upload pay stubs, W-2s, tax return. With that information, we're able to pre-approve you for a payment that you guys can qualify for. First and foremost is understanding your budget, which means how much money do you have to play with, either from savings, from gift, from relative, or wherever. And with that, what is your target max monthly payment? So we're trying to get you to a payment that you're comfortable with using the funds available. And with those two pieces of information, we can determine the max price point that you guys should be shopping at. At that point, you go back to your realtor and say, I don't want to go above $300,000, for example. Understanding your financial goals, short-term and long-term, what this means is that, as I mentioned, keeping homes as rental properties turned out to be the best accident that ever happened to us, and then we did it on purpose after that a few more times. But that's not for everybody. So what I find very interesting is that there are grant options available through Colorado Housing and Finance Authority. We're going to cover that. It's called CHAFA, C-H-F-A. And you go and you take a class right down the street on Blake Street, the first time homebuyer class. And with that, as long as your income is below the limit, which is, it, depending on the program, is somewhere between $80,000 and $100,000 a year. So as long as your salary is lower than that, you can qualify for grant money towards your bottom line due at closing. Now, the grant is free money that does not need to be repaid in some cases, but you pay a higher interest rate and a higher monthly payment. I feel, in terms of debunking the myth, that there's a lot of bad information in the marketplace about you shouldn't do the CHAFA loan, you shouldn't do an FHA loan. We're gonna cover those types of programs briefly, because they say, well, the interest rate is higher, or there's this mortgage insurance that we're gonna talk about, or whatever, that makes it a higher monthly payment and not the best loan. But in my opinion, if you have, let's say $10,000 available, and we can get you into a home for $5,500 and save $4,500 in savings, and your payment might be a little bit higher, but you plan to live in this house for 2, 3, 4 years before you sell and you buy another home, I would say take the money and run. Because to come up with the additional money out of pocket to get that lower rate and lower payment, you might spend an extra $5,000 to save, let's say, $50 a month. And you don't break even on spending that money versus the monthly savings for like 10 years. So sometimes it's like, well, if you're gonna live in this house for 3 years, take the free money, get into a home, stop paying someone else's mortgage and someone else's investment, and start building your own wealth for real estate investment. So the first thing is we understand your budget. The second thing is we talk about your goals. Do you see yourself keeping this long-term? That might affect the type of loan program that we're going to recommend to you. And then step three is we're going to cover a bunch of different options. And again, this is going to be a very cursory, fast, like 15-minute overview of a couple different types of programs, just so you guys can be like, okay, I kind of get the sense that this might be feasible. When we get together with our clients, it's like an hour long digging in deep. So we make sure we're tailoring the loan program and process to match you, your goals today, long term, et cetera. Another big thing to think about too, which a lot of first-time home buyers don't think about, is that your first home is really, I mean, you think about how many apartments have you rented? How different did your life look 3 years ago from how it looks today? I know my life looked really different 3 years ago, and what was important to me 3 years ago was totally different. And what I thought was going to be important to me 3 years later is totally different today than what I might have imagined then. So our life and our circumstances change quickly. Our jobs change. Our relationship status changes. Our preferences of neighborhood change. I mean, all kinds of things. So when I talk with folks about buying their first house, I always say, get what you need and nothing more. This isn't your forever home. It doesn't. It could be. It would be very unique if it was. So get yourself into something that falls below that budget, so it's comfortable, it's easy, and you feel like you're taking steps in the direction of your own financial freedom. Like you're getting behind the wheel and taking the reins, rather than renting and paying somebody else's financial freedom. That's what's happening, really. So we let you then choose your loan program based on all of the above. Today we're going to cover just a couple minimal entry loan programs. So just know that if you are someone who has 20% to put down and it's a no-brainer and you still have tons of savings in the bank after that's said and done, that's awesome. We're just going to talk about minimal entry, meaning how do you buy a home with a minimum amount available and still get the payment that works for you guys. It's working. Things to think about is that as you go lower on purchase price, you may find yourself shopping in the condo and townhome arena, which means that we need to consider the fact that when you buy a condo or a townhome, there may be HOA fees associated with that monthly payment. So we want to factor that into your budget. So if somebody's looking at numbers and we figure out that your target monthly payment of $2,000 a month as a max gets you a home of $300,000, but then you find a condo with a $300 a month HOA fee, we're gonna wanna scale that price point down. So we're gonna wanna lower the purchase price target to maybe $240,000 to leave wiggle room for that $300 a month HOA fee. So that's just something else to think about. Depending on your budget and goals and what you have available, some folks can purchase a home today with as little as $5,500, give or take, do a closing. And that's with those grant programs that I was talking about. So we'll kind of jump in here to a couple of products that are available. So the thing that I always like to emphasize with everyone on my team and what we like to bring forth is explanation of everything and anything possible, because I feel like when you're getting a mortgage for the first time, you're learning a new language. There's so much terminology, acronyms like FHA and CHAPA, and you're kind of just swimming in information that is like, and I just feel like a lot of people buy the first home and they're so confused by the amount of new information that they don't bother trying to understand it, and it makes the process feel overwhelming as a result. So our goal is to stop and slow down and explain at every stage of the process so that you're learning a new language while you're buying your first house, so that the second time around you're like, oh, I know what I'm doing here, and it can become a little easier. So FHA loans are a government loan, and you can do as little as 3.5% of the purchase price as your down payment. So on a $300,000 home, that would be $10,500, okay? Now, FHA loans are amazing for folks with any type of credit. Their interest rates are the lowest available. They do not penalize the interest rate on your loan based on risk factors like the size of your down payment or your credit score or anything of the sort. So FHA loans are great. What you need to know about them, which we'll dig into in a second here, is how they differ in terms of how the mortgage insurance on the loan is structured, and I'll explain what mortgage insurance is as well. Conventional loans are for private companies, publicly traded companies, Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac. And you can do as little as 3% down on your first time purchase, so $9,000 on a $300,000 house. The rates are going to be a little higher, and the rate is going to be very sensitive to credit score. If your credit score is 740 or above, you're going to get the same rates and terms on a conventional loan, regardless of whether your credit score is a 750 or an 800. However, for every 20 points that your score drops below 740, so to 720, 700, 680, 660, 640, 620, which is the minimum, you start to see the interest rate going up, which affects the monthly payment going up. The cost of the mortgage insurance, again, we'll explain in a moment, also goes up. So you start to see a compound increase in the cost of your monthly payment when any risk factors are present. And a risk factor is also having 3% down versus, say, 10 or 15 or 20, okay? So right out of the gates, even with a perfect credit score, you might compare conventional to FHA and see that the rate is gonna be a little better right out of the gates on FHA, and then get progressively worse if any additional risk factors present. CHAFA is the Colorado Housing and Finance Authority. Like I said, it's located at 19th and Blake. It's a great organization. You have to take a home buyer class, typically on a Saturday, in order to get access to the grant money. And it's shockingly engaging. And like, I found it to actually be enjoyable, even though I feel like mortgage is not necessarily sexy or fun. They make it really easy to understand, and it's kind of like going through this in a more in-depth all-day process. So this is the organization that provides grant money, and really the only restriction on it is the income restriction, that depending on the different type of program, you can't go above a certain amount in income or you don't qualify for this grant money. If you go to their website, again, for a government type website, it's actually really easy to navigate. The different types of programs are really well explained. The income limits are really clear and there in black and white. So if you did want to do any digging around, just Google CHAFA. You can play around on their site, and they've got tons of awesome resources. So FHA loans, nuts and bolts. As I mentioned, 3.5%. Here's the nuts and bolts. So it's a 620 minimum credit score, 3.5% minimum down payment. We'll talk about the mortgage insurance, and they have low interest rates. An estimated payment on a $300,000 home without an HOA, and including taxes and insurance in your monthly payment, would be about $1,900. The estimated total investment on an FHA loan, if you're paying your down payment and your closing fees out of pocket, would be about $15,500. What you need to know about mortgage insurance. So, mortgage insurance is sometimes referred to as PMI or MI, and all it is that when we're putting down less than 20% on a conventional loan, and on FHA loans, it's on all loans, we're paying this mortgage insurance to insure the bank against ourselves defaulting on the loan. In other words, because they're lending on what would be considered higher risk, because if they're giving us a loan for 97% of the purchase price, right, they're gonna have us pay a mortgage insurance as part of our loan to insure them against ourselves foreclosing, so that if we were to ever go into default on the loan and it was foreclosed upon, the bank would get some kind of compensation because we've been paying that insurance. So FHA's gotten a bad rap in recent years because a couple years back, FHA changed their guidelines where the mortgage insurance on the loan, if you do 3.5% down, is permanent for the life of the loan. And there's two pieces to this mortgage insurance. There's an upfront fee of 1.75% of the loan amount that gets added to the loan amount and spread out over the 30-year loan. And then there's a monthly premium, and that's included in your monthly payment. Now, if you go with a conventional loan, you have the option to do one or the other. Somebody could choose to pay a one-time lump sum upfront at closing and essentially buy off the mortgage insurance and have no monthly payment, meaning that their monthly payment obviously ends up lower for the life of the loan. Or they can go with the monthly premium. So when we're comparing minimum down options, if you're doing minimum down FHA and you're gonna have this monthly premium as part of your payment versus conventional with minimum down, you're probably gonna go with the monthly premium because you're trying to bring the minimum to closing, and paying it off is several thousand dollars. You're gonna typically find that your payment on FHA, just due to the lower rate, might end up actually being less. And the bad rap is you don't wanna do an FHA loan because you're gonna have this mortgage insurance for the life of the loan. So my response to that is, if you don't see yourself becoming a landlord someday and keeping this for the long haul, and it's probably a 3 to 5 year investment, I would say go with the FHA and get the lowest rate and payment, because on conventional, it could take you 6 to 9 years to get rid of that monthly premium anyway. Because on a conventional loan, you can either pay it upfront or you can pay it monthly, but eventually, if you hold that for a long period of time, that monthly premium falls away when you pay down your loan balance to below that 80% of the original purchase price or the value. So for example, we have folks right now that are moving out of their first condo. They're keeping it as a rental. They're moving into a townhome. They plan to live in it for a while, and someday it will probably become a rental. They know that, and they want to be minimum down, but because we know that's part of their strategy, we're not going to put them in an FHA loan. We know that this is a long-term investment, okay? So stop me any time if I'm saying anything.
What if this is the scenario, this is
so it's always on an FHA loan. If you do 3.5% down, it works out to be 0.85% of your loan amount. So in this case, with a loan amount of about 290, I mean, it's probably gonna be about $200 a month, 220 maybe, mm-hmm. as part of your monthly payment. Which is all factored into that $1,900. So this $1,900 includes homeowner's insurance that you guys set up, just like renter's insurance, taxes on the property, which are determined by the county, and then the mortgage insurance. So the total monthly payment is estimated, including all of that. So comparing that to conventional, with conventional, you see here that the estimated payment on $300,000 with 3% down is actually a little bit higher at $1,955 a month. The minimum credit score is 620. The minimum down payment is 3%. Now, that's only on your first home purchase. After that, it's a minimum of 5%. I starved the mortgage insurance just because I wanted to explain that whole thing of having a choice, of having paying it up front, paying it monthly. There's also options, which is digging a little too deep, but sometimes you can choose to go with a higher interest rate. And with that higher rate, you actually get a credit from the bank, and that could pay off that mortgage insurance premium. And it can also be used to cover some of those closing costs. So it's feasible in some cases to come to closing with just your down payment. So just $9,000, for example, here. Now, the reason I say estimated investment is about $14,000 cash to the closing is because we usually ballpark about $5,000 to $5,500 for the closing fees. And that's appraisal to value the property. There's a title company involved. They have their fees. And we dig into all this when people are actually buying their home, so I don't want to overwhelm you guys with all of that. But just a ballpark of about $5,000 is good to know for all the closing fees, taxes, and insurance, and that can be covered by the lender if you choose a higher rate of payment. So just know that if you didn't want to go the Jaffa route with the down payment assistance, you can still get some credit to cover your closing costs and then just bring $9,000 on a conventional or that $10,500 on FHA.
If you have a cosigner, does it change like the mortgage insurance part of it?
Great question.
And the insurance rate or the interest rates, things like this?
So that's an awesome question. So a cosigner's role is essentially to help improve your debt to income ratio. So when we pre-qualify someone for a home, we're looking first and foremost at the credit report and that minimum credit score of 620. Beyond that, we're looking at debt to income ratio. Essentially, your debt to income is your total gross income, if you're salaried, divided by 12. So if someone's salary, for example, is $48,000 divided by 12, is $4,000. On a conventional loan, the maximum debt to income is 50%, which means that your total monthly payments, including the mortgage, cannot exceed 50% of your gross monthly income. So if somebody makes $48,000 a year or $4,000 a month, total payments cannot exceed $2,000, okay? Now that includes the mortgage, car payments, student loan payments. Even if they're in deferment, we have to calculate a payment for the future repayment of any deferred student loans, and then any minimum payments on credit cards. So if somebody truly has no debt, meaning they don't have any credit cards that they use, no student loans and no car loans, then they can theoretically qualify for a $2,000 mortgage. But if they have $500 in other payments, they would be maxed at a $1,500 mortgage. FHA goes a little higher than that, to 55%, so you can get a little bit, you can qualify for a little bit more. A cosigner, the goal of having a cosigner, would mean, it's called a non-occupying cosigner. It means somebody that's gonna be on the loan to help you qualify, would be that they have additional income, maybe a low amount of debt, that combined you have a total higher income with lower debt, which qualifies folks for a little bit more. And that, you know, the times that we see that, obviously, we don't want our clients buying. I would never want to see somebody have a mortgage payment that's 50% of their gross income that they're paying by themselves, because the take home is even less than the $4,000, right? So I wouldn't want to see somebody have a mortgage payment be 60% of what they take home every month or something. But in some cases, there might be two people living in the home. You know, maybe someone's recently become self-employed, we can't count their income, but we know there's two people living in the home, that might be an opportunity to have a cosigner come in to add that additional income. But we don't want to see folks overextending. In fact, it's the opposite. That's why I was saying, when you buy your first place, just get what you need and nothing more. It's just a stepping stone. It's just a baby step. So like, if you think you're comfortable with a $200,000 condo, go out and look at everything under 150 to start. And exhaust that before you go all the way to your max. Because you might find yourself in a bidding war where you need to go a little higher than what that asking price is in order to get the house. And you'd much rather be extremely comfortable after you buy your first place because it's fun. I mean, you're gonna wanna go to Home Depot and cans of paint are like $40, I think. So, you know, it's fun to make your first place a home. So you have to kind of keep that in mind. There's gonna be other expenses that come up that you wanna plan for that didn't exist when you were a renter. So I just think like, just get something. I mean, anything, you can make anything awesome. I mean, a lot of you probably live in dorm rooms with two twin beds and we made those awesome. So maybe you make a condo pretty sweet. So anyways, things to know about conventional I already talked about. If you do the 20% down, you can avoid the mortgage insurance. I think this is worth touching upon. I know we're getting a little short on time, but here's the thing about avoiding mortgage insurance. And I'm just gonna give my 2 cents on this, okay? Because when we bought our first place, as I mentioned, we had nothing. We bought with an FHA loan, we did the minimum amount down, we got into a little row home, it was a one bedroom, University Park, for $95,000 when that existed 10 years ago. And we kept that, and because we put the minimum down, and because we bought way below our budget, our max was 180, and we bought for 95. We were able to save some money, at least a little bit. So when we bought the second home, we found it before the first was on the market. So we ended up scraping together just the bare minimum to get that second place, and then rented the first. And the rental income from the first place was actually higher in total amount than the new mortgage. So even though our mortgage went from like 900 to 1300, it was renting for 1600, so we actually were paying less. It actually decreased our cash flow. By the time we bought the fourth property, the rental income from the first three was bringing $1,500 a month. So we were either looking at a $300 a month mortgage payment on our fourth property, or we were looking at something that covered the cost of childcare. So I'm not a huge proponent of doing the full 20% down, unless, like I said, it's a no-brainer. You've got tons of savings beyond that. Because what happens is, when that money's put into your home, it's no longer accessible to you. So if you buy a place for $300,000 and you put down $60,000 and you lose your job and you're like, shoot, I can really use that money. There's $60,000 that's tied up in my house. Guess what? You can't qualify even to refinance to get your money back out because you don't have a job and you literally have to get a new loan to get your money back. So the other thing is, if you can keep some, at least have some money that's liquid and available in savings and reserves, that prepares you for opportunities like buying more real estate if you want, or emergencies. So even if, I just think, we hear a lot of people, like, I'm trying to scrape down enough to avoid the mortgage insurance. Well, guess what? On a conventional loan, the difference between doing 10% down, let's say on a $300,000 house, putting down $30,000 versus putting down $60,000. The extra $30,000 that you're putting down saves you about $150 a month in your payment. It's shocking. Every $20,000 difference on purchase price is only about $100 a month. And keep that in mind too when you're shopping around for properties, because it may have come down to, I need to increase my offer price by another $5,000 to get this house. And you're like, oh, $5,000. That's $5,000 over 30 years. And that's gonna cost you a difference of $25 a month in mortgage. So the crazy thing is that when folks are like, I'm gonna put down 20%, and it means depleting all my savings, save $150 a month, you don't break even on spending $30,000 today to save $150 for 16 years. I just think keep your money liquid, have it available for other opportunities or emergencies. Okay, so any questions about this slide? Okay, CHAFA. Now, CHAFA is not a different loan program from conventional or FHA. It is simply supplemental money towards your bottom line behind or on top of a conventional or an FHA mortgage. So we're still gonna pick the first mortgage program based on your goals. It's either gonna be FHA or conventional. And then we're gonna decide whether you want to go with a 3% grant or a 4% second mortgage. This is an important distinction. So the 3% grant is 3% of your loan amount. So in the example of a $300,000 purchase price, with a conventional loan, you're putting down $9,000, you're borrowing $291,000. You're getting a grant for 3% of the $291,000. So it almost covers the whole 3% down payment. And it leaves you having to pay your closing costs. What's important to know is there is an extra 1% of the loan amount fee associated with doing a check alone. So those estimated closing costs of $5,000 that I mentioned earlier, on a $291,000 loan, that goes up to about closer to $8,000. So the beauty of the grant is it doesn't have to be repaid. So they give you the money, the interest rate is higher, the payment is higher, but you can come to closing with just those closing costs of roughly $8,000, give or take. That's why it says here, cash to the closing, $5,400 to $8,400. The 4% second mortgage, that's actually a loan. There's no monthly payment on it, but when you sell the property, you still owe that back. It just kind of sits there like a silent lien. There's no interest rate on it, there's no payment on it, okay? The interest rate's a little lower on the second mortgage, so you get a better payment, and you only bring about $5,400 to closing. And that's, again, just to cover that closing cost and a little bit more. And then the max income is around $80,000 to $92,000 a year, and we have some where household income, if there's two homeowners, they do look at household income. So that's where you go over $100,000 in combined income, okay? So, any questions about CHAFA? Okay, so the bottom line is think big. I can't speak highly enough about the decisions that we made accidentally 10 years ago and what it's done for our family and our life. And the best program is going to just totally depend on you. So we're just going to dig in one-to-one when folks come to meet with us. And yeah, I think that's it. If you want to reach out to us, we'll leave our contact information. And then, as Georgia mentioned, we were thinking that we could do a follow-up happy hour in like a month or so, and we could all get together, whoever wants to come, if you just want to like hang out for a few hours and small talk and pick our brains or whatever. And obviously, we're happy to meet one-on-one too. So, thanks, guys. Thank you.